The inexact line search algorithm is quite simple. It works with trials and errors. It starts with a candidate step. And if the step is too long, it makes it shorter. If the step is too short, it makes it longer. What we would like to do in this video is to make sure that this process will finish in a finite number of iterations. Let's first recall the two Wolf conditions. The first one guarantees a sufficient decrease in the objective function as compared to the length of the step. It is designed to reject steps that are too long. The second Wolf condition guarantees a sufficient progress of the algorithm and rejects steps that are too short. These two conditions are parameterized with two parameters beta 1 and beta 2, and they are compatible if beta 1 is strictly less than beta 2, both parameters being strictly between 0 and 1. The line search algorithm can be described as follows. So at each iteration, we maintain three numbers, a lower bound on the left part, which is alpha L, an upper bound on the right part, which is alpha R. It's usually initialized with plus infinity, so it's not represented on this picture. And then the current candidate, which is alpha I. If alpha I violates the first Wolf condition, it means that the step is too long. Therefore, we update the value of the upper bound, alpha R, and we set it to the previous value of alpha I. The value of alpha L is the same. And the new value for alpha I plus 1, is calculated as the middle of the interval between alpha L and alpha R. Now, if this alpha I plus 1 violates the second Wolf condition, it means that this step is too short. In this case, we update the value of the left bound, alpha L, using this value of the parameter. We keep the same value for alpha R. And now the value of alpha I plus 2, so the second iteration, is equal to the middle of the interval between the new alpha L and the new alpha R. And then we continue like this, depending on which condition is violated. And we stop when both conditions are verified. There is one special case that was not discussed in the previous slide, is that if the step is not too long, so if the Wolf 1 condition is verified, but that the second Wolf condition is violated, meaning that the step is too short, and the alpha R, the upper bound, has not been updated yet, it's still at plus infinity like it is in the beginning of the algorithm, then we cannot calculate the middle of the interval. So in this case, what we do is that we simply increase the step by an arbitrary factor, which must be greater than 1, let's say typically 2, which would mean that we would double the size of the step. So this is just a special case that happens only when alpha R is equal to plus infinity, and then we increase the step when it's too short. Let's see some properties of these parameters. First, the lower bound alpha L always verifies Wolf 1. Indeed, it's updated only when Wolf 1 is verified and Wolf 2 is violated. For the same reason, it always violates Wolf 2. And finally, alpha R always violates Wolf 1. It is initialized at plus infinity and is updated each time Wolf 1 is violated. Okay, so alpha L verifies Wolf 1 and violates Wolf 2, and alpha R violates Wolf 1. The first thing we want to prove is that alpha I is finite. Well, let's do it by contradiction. Suppose by contradiction that alpha I goes to infinity, it means that the upper bound alpha R is always plus infinity. It means that Wolf 1 is never violated, which is impossible because we have assumed that the function is bounded from below. And if you remember, an argument that we have used in previous video is that if the function is bounded from below, the condition for Wolf 1 at some point will cross the function. So there exists a maximum step length that verifies Wolf 1, which is finite. Okay, so we have the guarantee that at some point, if we keep on increasing alpha I, it will violate Wolf 1, and therefore alpha r will be updated to a finite number, which guarantees that all the subsequent alpha I will be finite. From now on, we will consider only iterations that are associated with a finite value for alpha r. So it means that at each of these iterations, the new value of alpha will be the middle point of alpha l and alpha r, which means that the interval alpha l, alpha r will decrease at each iteration by 2, actually. The second result that we want to show is that this algorithm will terminate after a finite number of iterations. And this result is numbered theorem 1110 in the book, and we can prove it like this. Suppose, again by contradiction, that there is an infinite number of iterations. It means that because we decrease by 2 the length of the interval at each iteration, it means that the length of this interval will converge to 0. So the distance between alpha r and alpha l, as I goes to infinity, will converge to 0. Consequently, the value of alpha, which is in the middle of alpha l and alpha r, will converge to a given value that I denote by alpha star. So alpha star is actually the limit of the three quantities that we maintain at each iteration that will all converge to the same value. Alpha r, alpha l, and alpha I. Now we will use the properties that we have identified. The first property is that alpha l verifies the first Wolf condition for all I. So it means that at the limit, alpha star will also verify Wolf 1. So this is what I have written here. So this is the first Wolf condition where alpha is equal to alpha star. Now we have seen also that the first Wolf condition is violated by all alpha I r. Okay, so it means that because alpha star verifies Wolf 1, alpha star cannot be equal to any of the alpha I r. It would be inconsistent. It means that I can write that f of xk plus alpha r I dk is strictly greater than f of xk plus alpha r I beta 1 times the directional derivative. Now at the limit, when I goes to infinity, well, this inequality will continue to be verified, but at the limit, it may happen that it is actually reached as an inequality. So we can write this inequality. So when we put the two together, we obtain the equality. So we obtain that f of xk plus alpha star dk is equal to f of xk plus alpha star beta 1 times the directional derivative. So to obtain this result, we have exploited two properties of the algorithm. One, that the first Wolf condition is verified for all alpha L, and then the first Wolf condition is violated by all alpha R. So from the previous slides, we have reached this equality, this equation here, and from which we can actually derive the value of f of xk. Now we go back to this property that the first Wolf condition is violated by all alpha r, as we've seen before. So it means that alpha star is different from alpha r, as we discussed, but it's also strictly less, so we have this inequality. And this means that it is violated, and now we can replace f of xk by the value that we have calculated before. So we obtain this expression. We can write it as this. Now I exploit the fact that alpha r I minus alpha star is positive, as we have seen here. This is because alpha r is always greater or equal to alpha star, but it's also different from alpha star. So we can do that. We can divide here. So now we obtain this inequality. So this is the inequality that we have just derived. And now we calculate the limit when I goes plus infinity. Well, in this case, the left part is nothing else than the directional derivative of the function f along dk, because alpha ir is converging to alpha star. And now we will exploit two things. We will exploit the fact that beta 2 is greater than beta 1, and the fact that the directional derivative here is negative, which means that the negative number, which is the directional derivative, is multiplied by a quantity which is strictly greater than beta 1, so we obtain something which is strictly lower. Okay, so that's the inequality that we have reached using the properties of the algorithm about Wolf 1. So that's the current result, right? This is the inequality that we have derived, is that the directional derivative in alpha star is strictly bigger than beta 2 times the directional derivative at alpha equals 0. And now we exploit the last property of this algorithm that says that alpha L violates Wolf 2, the second Wolf condition, for all I. It means that for all L, the directional derivative at alpha L is strictly less than beta 2 times the directional derivative at alpha 0 for all I. Now, if we send I to infinity, alpha IL will converge to alpha star, and the strict inequality will become less or equal. And now we obtain a contradiction. So we have reached two conclusions, one here and one here, which are not compatible. So because we have derived this contradiction assuming that the number of iterations would be infinite, we see that the algorithm will reach a valid step in a finite number of iterations. The Wolf conditions characterize valid steps. And we have seen that the simple algorithm that works with trial and errors by increasing the step if it is too short, decreasing it if it is too long, will eventually find a valid step after a finite number of iterations. So that's something that we can use in practice.